Today's lecture will focus on recombinant protein expression in Escherichia coli. Escherichia coli is a prokaryotic bacterial host, which is gram-negative, and it has now become the workhorse of the biotech industry. In terms of application, you can basically express proteins for laboratory application as well as proteins for industrial use. So if you have, for instance, a gene, you have isolated a gene from an organism, and you want to ascertain whether this gene encodes a protein, the way you can basically identify whether this gene encodes a protein is by inserting it into E. coli and expressing it as a heterologous protein. So once it's expressed, you get evidence for expression of that specific gene.
It's same like the cloning, is it?
Yeah, it's same like cloning, but in this case, it involves expression of the protein. In the case of cloning, you have a plasmid vector, which is not designed for expression of protein. It's designed to carry fragments of DNA.
Okay.
In the case of expression of proteins, you have a vector which is assigned a specific promoter.
The vector is E. coli also?
The vector is a plasmid vector. E. coli is the host.
Oh, okay,
so
okay.
The term we use for this is the vector is the plasmid,
okay.
The bacterium is the host.
Okay.
So let's see the basics. So you have your gene of interest, and you have to ensure that your gene of interest is an intact open reading frame.
Intact open reading frame.
That's the first criterion for developing a gene construct. So an example of an open reading frame will be a codon. For instance, you have 300 nucleotides.
Okay.
300 bases. And then you divide it by 3. So you get 100 amino acids. So this constitutes an open reading frame.
Okay.
However, if I had 301 nucleotides and I divide it by 3, the number of codons, it won't be an integer. It will be 100 points something.
Yeah.
So this is not an open reading frame. So one of the first steps which you need to ascertain is your open reading frame. You need to ensure that your open reading frame is intact, and you need to ensure that the open reading frame encodes the desired amino acid sequence.
Mm-hmm.
This is the first step in gene construction. So once you have verified your open reading frame, you need to place a start and stop codon. That's your gene. So if you have a start and stop codon. If you decide to express an open reading frame from a eukaryotic system in E. coli, you should ensure that it does not contain any introns.
Okay.
It should be intronless.
Okay.
Because E. coli does not have the ability to splice out introns.
Okay.
So that's your gene construct. The start codon, the stop codon, and the intact open reading frame, which we'll term as ORF.
Okay.
Now this construct will not express in E. coli unless you have a promoter binding site upstream of the gene. So at the 5' end, you have a promoter binding site and a ribosomal binding site. So you have to have these components, promoter binding site and ribosomal binding site.
Binding site, okay.
And at the end, at the 3' end,
also the same. Sir.
You have to ensure that you have a terminator sequence. So in bacteria, we have rho-dependent termination and rho-independent termination. So in E. coli, generally we use a terminator which basically ensures that this open reading frame is expressed and nothing beyond it. So anything else beyond it does not get transcribed and translated, or else we'll have an error.
Okay,
so this is your gene construct. A promoter binding site, the ribosome binding site, the gene of interest with an open reading frame, and the terminator sequence.
Terminator sequence.
So You must remember that a promoter binding site is not a protein, it's a sequence, it's a specific sequence. So in E. coli system, we have a BL21 system. We use a T7 promoter sequence, which is basically a DNA sequence. Now that you have this construct in place, you can ligate it onto your plasmid DNA vector. So this is your plasmid DNA. So as you have studied in earlier lectures, your plasmid DNA vector will have a origin of replication, will have a selectable marker, one or more. So in this case, it can be kanamycin, ampicillin resistance marker, or chloramphenicol resistance, so you can have, and you can have a reporter. In some cases, you can have a reporter gene as well.
Reporter gene.
A reporter gene may be a chromophore, a color. When you have this, for instance, you transform this vector into E. coli, you can trace it in terms of its color, chromogenic, or you can trace it in terms of its selection on antibiotic medium.
Doctor, the promoter sequence is in DNA, it's basically like primers, is it?
A promoter sequence is a region of the DNA which is encodes a specific sequence. Okay? This sequence does not get translated into protein. However, a promoter is a protein. It's a protein. So when you have a protein, you have, for example, you have a T7 promoter. So the transcriptase will bind to this promoter binding site. Once it binds to this, it will initiate the transcription of the RNA.
Okay.
So this is why you need to have a specific site. Now this promoter binding site is specific for this specific promoter. So if you have a T7 RNA polymerase, it requires a T7 promoter binding site. For instance, if you do not have, you use a bacterium such as BL21, E. coli BL21, you need to have a T7.
When we order the plasmid, the promoter binding site come together, or how does that?
Okay, so when you order the plasmid, it will basically contain the promoter binding site, the ribosome binding site, the termination sequence, and it will contain a multiple cloning site at this location. Contains an MCS, multiple cloning site. This is where you ligate your gene of interest. So, in the earlier days, we used restriction enzyme. For example, you have EcoR1, BAMH1. So you digest or restrict this enzyme with EcoR1, BAMH1, and then you insert your gene of interest in this multiple cloning site, following which it gets expressed as a protein. So the most promoters, most plasmids come with this backbone. They are sold as empty backbones. So one of our plasmids which we use is the PET22 series, PET22. They come with a construct with a promoter binding site, which is the T7 promoter, EcoR1, and BAMH1 restriction sites. They have multiple restriction sites. They'll have HindI3, they'll have XHO1. So you can select the restriction site which you need. Because the restriction enzyme which you use to cleave your plasmid should not cleave your gene. So if you have a cleavage site, for example, XHO1 in the center of your gene, and if you cleaved your plasmid with XHO1, and you cleaved your gene with XHO1, your gene will get truncated. So your gene compatibility is based on the selection of restriction enzyme. It's clear? The restriction enzyme which you select to restrict this plasmid or cleave this plasmid should not cleave your gene.
Should not cleave our gene of interest.
The gene of interest. It should only cleave the multiple cloning site. Otherwise, you'll end up cleaving your gene and you'll get a truncated gene.
Okay.
So that's your basis for design. So now that you have your plasmid DNA, you'll have your plasmid DNA, sample PET22 with gene of interest or you can transform it into E. coli.
Host.
E. coli, which is the host. So you transform it by using, if you are using chemically competent E. coli, you can transform it using heat shock. Mm-hmm. If you are using the electro-competent E. coli, you can transform using the ballistic method, so you can use the electroporation. Yes, so now your gene is in your coli. Once the plasmid is transformed into E. coli, it will not translate the protein unless you induce it with a specific signal. Mm-hmm. So you have to understand that there is a factor which you have to take into account, which is compatibility between your plasmid vector and the host. Okay. They have to be compatible with each other. Uh-huh. For example, when you use PET22, we generally use BL21.
Okay.
So BL21 contains a T7 RNA polymerase. So this T7 RNA polymerase is induced by the addition of IPTG. So you add IPTG, this will signal the plasmid polymerase, and then you will have a transcription. So if you don't add IPTG, you will not get expression of your gene of interest.
But we want the expression to happen, right, doctor?
We want the expression to happen, but we want to the expression to take place at a certain time period.
Oh.
We don't, for instance, if I transform the gene of interest into E. coli and then it commences expression at this stage, a large amount of energy will be utilized for protein expression and the bacterial cell will lose out on division.
Okay.
So the general practice is you transform the gene of interest into E. coli and then you permit the E. coli to grow for between 12 to 16 hours. After 12 to 16 hours of growth, you then induce the expression
IPTG.
Of protein by adding IPTG.
IPTG is a what, of the enzyme or?
No, it's an analog of a sugar. So I'll give you the formula.
Oh, okay.
So IPTG is a sugar analog. So once you add it to the E. coli, it will express.
So once it's the E. coli propagate, see?
Yeah.
Then we introduce the IPTG.
Yeah. So after you introduce IPTG, you'll get the expression of protein if everything is okay.
Okay.
I mean, if your gene of interest is in place and all, you have satisfied all the criteria. So your E. coli will express the protein of interest. However, because you are expressing the protein of interest at a very high copy number, your plasmid will be at a very high copy number and the protein production will reach a certain threshold at which point the E. coli will misfold the proteins. So generally when proteins are expressed in E. coli, they are not in their native state because they are expressed at a very high concentration.
Okay.
So these proteins are expressed as either as inclusion bodies or misfolded protein aggregates.
Okay.
So protein will be expressed in a non-native form. So in most cases, the protein will be not biologically active. The protein is, for example, if you express an enzyme and it's expressed as an inclusion body or as an aggregate, it's not completely active or it's partially active.
Okay, these two forms are not active.
Not active, aggregates and inclusion bodies.
Okay.
So the native form will be at a very low threshold and this native form will be active. So in general, what we do, once we complete the process of protein expression, We lyse this E. coli, we sonicate it, and we lyse this in a buffer like PBS.
Okay.
And once you lyse them, these proteins which have been aggregated have to be linearized using a strong denaturant such as urea. So once you express the protein, you lyse the cell, you then use urea or other strong denaturants to linearize the protein. You unfold the entire protein. And you then refold the protein. You can, for instance, you can use a dialysis bag and you have urea, homomolar urea, and then you dialyze this protein. You dialyze it, you basically pass the solvent you dialyze this protein. Now, as the protein is dialyzed, it will revert to its natural conformation.
Okay.
So, you have to understand that in the E. coli, right, there is something, a phenomenon known as macromolecular crowding. The E. coli is a very small cell. You're overexpressing a protein which is not native to the E. coli. So what they will do, they will basically misfold it because they have too much protein to process.
Okay.
So they will misfold it into aggregate. So as a biologist, as a molecular biologist, our role is to assist the E. coli in refolding. So we basically linearize it using urea and we refold it by dialysis. Because E. coli protein, right? For instance, you have a protein. If you have a cysteine, as you will have a disulfide bond formation, you'll need to ensure that the disulfide bonds are restored. Because E. coli has an enzyme which will facilitate the isomerization. However, if you subject it to conditions where the protein is overexpressed and you have macromolecular crowding, this disulfide bond cannot form. So then the protein will be no longer active. So this part has to be done in vitro.
In vitro?
In vitro, outside of the cell.
So you take the whole E. coli out?
Yeah, you take the whole E. coli out. We usually pellet the E. coli down and we get a cell paste. We then add enzymes and we use sonication to break down the cell wall. We can use lysozyme, for instance. And after it's out of the cell, we recover the proteins. And we then subject them to this process of refolding. So there are basically many stages in this process of protein expression.
Are we going to do this one, doctor, practical?
No, not as part of practical. So the first step is your plasmid and your gene construction. The second step is transformation into the host. The third step involves induction of the protein production. The fourth step involves recovery of this protein. So we recover the expressed proteins by lysis of the cell. We lyse the cell and we recover these proteins. Then we subject them to denaturation and refolding. So this is the basic procedure involved in production of recombinant proteins in E. coli.
Okay.